I'm Samantha Bryant, and here I am at Congregate 2018. I'm best known as the author of the Menopausal Superhero series, but tonight I'm going to read from another short story altogether. This is from a collection called The Seven Story House, which was a little labor of love between me and some friends, trying to learn how publishing works by putting together a little book. So this story is called Goldilocks, and I think that probably tells you enough. Goldilocks. Debbie walked across the field, still wet from the rainstorm she'd been caught in the night before, the one she'd spent beneath an underpass trying to huddle in the center where the rain couldn't reach. If her sneakers hadn't already been soaked, walking across the field would have done the job. As it was, she hardly noticed the additional wetness. She was already wet to her knees anyway, and cursing herself for her stupidity with every additional step. A house set a few hundred yards back from the road. It had that lonely look of an abandoned house, and she thought it might do for a night's shelter. She definitely didn't want to walk any further without a chance to dry out her clothes, especially her shoes. It had to be better than another night outside, even if it was technically trespassing. The sun had nearly disappeared behind the mossy, crumbling chimney by the time she made it to the door, so she took out her flashlight. She held it upright in her hand, so it would be useful as a light or a weapon, whichever she found she needed most. She had regretted the weight of the large, heavy flashlight many times in the past few days of traveling by foot, but she found it comforting now. The door to the house hung ajar. The glass panel beside it lay shattered on the broken-down porch. That boded well for getting in, but less well for what she'd find once inside. Probably a variety of rodents and other field creatures had made their homes in there. From the condition of the clapboard, she guessed it had been at least 20 years since the house had been occupied by anyone who cared for it. She kicked the door the rest of the way open and stood to the side in case anything large enough to hurt her wanted to rush out. The hinges creaked a horrible metallic shriek, a sound that set her teeth on edge. She waited, flashlight aloft. When nothing menacing announced its presence, Debbie stepped through the doorway gingerly, accompanied by only a few night bugs and a large white-winged moth. The last rays of fading light shone through the broken panes of the windows and revealed a living room. Whoever abandoned the house must have done so in a hurry. The living room was still fully furnished, including an enormous and heavy-looking 1970s-era television set with a pair of honest-to-God rabbit ears. A crumpled bit of tinfoil rested over the base, collecting dust. Debbie took in the heavy floral furnishings and the cheesy pictures of the Precious Moments praying girl dangling crookedly over the sofa and laughed. Somebody's grandmother had suffered from a Home Shopping Network addiction. "Hi, Grandma," she called to the room with a bravado she didn't really feel. "Got anything to eat?" Hearing no answer, Debbie stepped to the nearest armchair and kicked it with her squishy wet sneaker, sending us a cloud of dust and releasing a musty smell into the already stale and stagnant air of the room. Several alarmingly large and many-legged bugs scuttled up the arms and into the cushions. She wouldn't be making her bed on any of this furniture tonight. She'd prefer to sleep alone, thank you. She clicked on her flashlight and turned to examine the rest of what could be seen by its light, hoping to find somewhere to rest. The living room made up most of the bottom floor of the house. One wall was a large fireplace. Debbie knelt and shined her light up the chimney. She heard scurrying sounds and hurried to get a fire lit before any furry friends could get too close. She had matches and a lighter in her backpack, and there were some old newspapers and magazines spilled on the floor, so she felt sure she could get a fire started. She'd burn pieces of the house itself if she had to, so she could be dry and warm. She shivered in spite of the warm summer air and hoped she wasn't going to get sick. It had been stupid of her, sleeping beneath the underpass, stubborn and stupid. Sure, she'd been tired and hadn't wanted to keep walking, but she hadn't rested well, and it definitely hadn't been worth the day's walk in waterlogged sneakers. She should have kept walking until she found something better. It was just another in the string of bad decisions that brought her to this point. Now she was going to have blisters and catch a cold, and there was still a lot of miles between here and home. She'd always had a hard time finding the right path and staying on it. At last the fire took, and the newspapers and magazines crumpled as they were consumed. By firelight, she spotted a small wooden chair sitting by the wall. When she picked it up, it fell into pieces. Just right, she thought to herself, and lugged the fragments to the fireplace and tossed them in. The fire blazed after that, and Debbie sat to remove her wet clothes and pants. Her skin was clammy and cold. She spread the clothes out on the hearthstone, watching carefully to be sure that the flames were staying contained and the smoke was actually going up the chimney. The crackling and popping sounds were comforting, like the voices of old friends. She dug through her backpack again, pushing aside her notebook and a bag of soiled clothes and pulling out a pair of mostly dry socks and some shorts and finding a tin of canned meat. It wasn't enough to eat, but it was the end of what she brought with her, so it would have to do, even if she was still hungry. Sitting as near the fire as she dared, she turned her body to heat one side and then the other, lifting her long blonde hair to better feel the heat on her back and arms. She smelled terrible. She'd have to find a way to bathe before letting her brother see her. She didn't want him to know how bad she had let things get. Listening to the wind blowing through the trees, she relaxed a bit. It was peaceful here in the house in the woods. She had always found comfort in small, homey sounds like rustling leaves and crackling fires. If the house was cleaner, she might have stayed here a good long while. She hadn't told anyone she was coming, so it wasn't like she was expected at a certain time. She could do this at her own pace. She picked up a sneaker and tried to wring it out, but it was no good. They would take hours to dry out, and that meant she'd be here for the night. She sat and watched the fire blaze. It grew large enough that she had to move further away from it. Her stomach rumbled, and she wished she'd gone ahead and spent her last $10 on a full breakfast this morning instead of settling for the oatmeal just because it was cheap. The $10 wouldn't make the rest of her journey easier. It wasn't enough to buy her a ride or a bed. She leaned over and rummaged through the pocket of her drying jeans, pulled the bill out, and smoothed it against her thigh, studying it in the unsteady light of the fire. It was her last money in this world, and it wasn't even really hers. She'd stolen it, along with the rest of the 50-odd dollars from Stephen 4 days earlier when she finally left. The little backpack with her few clothes, a few cans of food, the flashlight, and her notebook had been all she'd taken, less than she had arrived with when she came to Richmond. I think that's where I'll stop.